Okay, good evening, everybody. Today we are welcoming to the EA the architect Pedro Campos Costa and environmental engineer Eduardo Costa Pinto to present the editorial work summarizing this very interesting book that you can find later up there, Seven Circles, intended to question the limits of contemporary city. This book is reading Lisbon from different perspectives using photography, geographical information, mapping, and critical reflections to create and contribute to the city. The volume comprises the work of 14 authors, among whom we can find Michael Sorkin and architect Mary Bowman, who is here and will be later in the roundtable, reflecting on different questions regarding Lisbon's contemporary condition. Behind this book, there is the aim to think, look, investigate, discover, speculate, and create new perspectives on the limit of cities. This lecture today will start with a theatrical performance by Amandio Pinheiro and Martinho Silva, I hope I say it okay, to continue with the presentation by Pedro Campos Costa and Eduardo Costa Pinto, and to finish with the round table with both editors and the Lisbon-based architect Mary Bowman, and moderated by Victorian Albert Museum curator Mariana Pestana. Okay. Well, a note on the editors. Pedro Campos Costa studied architecture in the University of Porto and Delft University of Technology, has a PhD in architectural and urban culture by the University of Coimbra. He's an architect founder of Lisbon-based office Campos Costa Architects, winner of several prizes, such as the FAD in 2014, the Prémio Valmor by Lisbon City Hall, Europe 40 under 40 in 2012, and Next Generation by Metropolis Magazine, among other prizes. His office is conceived as an interdisciplinary research and development practice to inform architectural design. On the other hand, Eduardo Costa Pinto began his graduate studies in environmental engineering at the Technical University of Lisbon, and graduated in landscape architecture from Higher Institute of Agronomy of the University of Lisbon as well. His professional activity started in 2007, and since then has collaborated with several studios in Portugal and Italy, including Margem, Arquitectura Paisagista, Derrecta Urban Management, Promontorio Architects Proap, and Proap Italia. Since 2011, he has begun working independently, conducting studies and projects of landscape architecture. For today, it's a pleasure to welcome both of you and present this super interesting work that I have the opportunity to review this weekend. Thank you very much for coming, and yeah, you can start.
So we will speak only of the city boundaries of Lisbon. Where are we going?
Sea of straw. Each one of us lives in a watershed.
Magritte shows us a landscape as seen through a window. Between this window and the observer, there is a painting. But there seems to be no boundaries between the painting and the outside view. Pastoral and horticultural. Farmers and the persistent worship of the Virgin Mary.
Knock, knock. Centuries have passed. Nature knocks on city doors.
The world without us.
The ruin disappears, even if only for a few brief moments, when a place triggers a memory.
Both in the 14th century, Lisbon, and in the Big Brother era, we perceive the limit between good and bad government.
Sitting on his horse, there seems no wonder that the King Don José, from above, is looking in the direction of Brazil. From ancient Greece comes the notion that the world of ideas and the physical world can be separated.
Renaturalize, reduce, reuse, recycle, rehabilitate.
21st century, the re-century.
Good fences make good
nightmares.
Neighbors. Good fences make good neighbors.
Good fences make good neighbors. Eduardo.
The place was there.
The person appeared.
The person left.
The place continued.
The place had made the person.
The person had transformed the place.
The Northern Hinterland.
Eviscerating the rural periphery.
One could tell the story of the city of Lisbon through its relationship to the river. The 1852 Ring Road and Salazar's Golden Gate from 1962.
Prison, radiant panoptic.
The city has arrows, it has directions, it says this way, that way. The arrow is a strong symbol. Origin, destination. A clear horizontal and spatial movement. A rapid movement. In the midst of this, the tree seems from another world, like it's distracted. It's no arrow, it's not urgent. And yes, it moves, but upwards, and downwards, and slowly, very slowly. Let's think about the other side of this image. The night. During the night, the lamppost places one light with backs facing the other light, bringing light to both sides. But only on the lower level. Raise your eyes upwards, and the night remains immensely dark. On the other side, someone wants what I have. This is why load-bearing utensils with wheels were invented. Things are always moving. Even boring things that don't talk. You can see two passages in the distance. They're not solutions, just passages. You are here and you have a problem. You go to the other side and you still have the same problem. But it's good that there's passages. Men are as tall as what they build. cities different height, an artificial range of artificial mountains. The idea that height, it's something that depends on human effort and conviction, it's not insignificant. You can't say the same thing about mountains, for example. It's an attempt to prove that man is stronger than water. But obviously the attempt is only symbolic, and when water truly rises, symbols drown, disappear, they are destroyed. Old and important activities such as fishing can live side by side with modern activities such as running without a set destination. Running because one wants to pay attention to one's body and not to the place one is going to. Fishing and fitness. Years of distance within the same. Colors and sizes have a calming effect when they are constant or when they vary with a predictable pattern. When architecture is ordered, the eye can pay attention to other eyes. This isn't better or worse. It's an old, almost animal instinct of paying attention first of all to that which can mean danger. Despite everything, like somebody who lives far away and sends a postcard every now and then so they won't be forgotten. And in the city as well, sometimes, suddenly, a tree, or even many trees. Who would have thought? What used to work in the past often turns to landscape. Let us consider, for instance, a motor that is irreparably broken down. It's no longer a motor, it becomes an object, something with pieces that is looked at. Sometimes the purpose of something that no longer holds a purpose, it's just to be beautiful. And that, of course, it's already a lot. Even when one part of the city seems very empty, if you look closely, you'll find it's very crowded.
Identità, precisione, interezza,
no.
Prospettiva.
Circolare.
Circolare, traiettoria.
No.
No.
Rassicurante, sicurezza, semplice.
No.
No.
Eterno.
Eterno.
Simulacro, imprevisto.
No.
No.
Infelice. Esplosione. Pianificare.
No.
Completo. Vasculare. Obbligazione.
No.
Sincope. Allontanamento. Intrincare.
No.
Leggerezza. Inquieto. Relegare.
No.
Fortuna. Consolidato, separare,
no.
Inserito, allontanare, sincrasia,
no.
Visuale, inferiore, incorporato,
no.
Guadagnare bilancio, sedentario, immerso, no.
Por favor, não! Vai lá crescer para outra pedra! Argamassa qualquer! Estraga os meus vinhos! Para onde é que aqueles todos vão?
Não te preocupes, rapariga! Não é o que parece. É uma massagem pesada. Quando eles passam tão depressa que mal se nota. E ficas com montes de momentos livres. Além disso, se ficares à superfície e apanhas tanto sol, mal sentes o que quer que seja.
Sobreviveste ontem à noite?
A sério? O que é que se passa com estes jovens hoje em dia?
Olha, este parece bastante inocente.
Parece.
A contemplar o infinito. Está?
Está só. Sinto falta de ver tanto carro a passar, a grande velocidade. Luz a iluminar-me de repente.
Mas nada que se compare com a visão de todos aqueles pontinhos lá em cima durante a noite.
Milhões de milhões movendo-se devagar.
Quê? O que é que disseste?
Não te preocupes. De qualquer das maneiras, ele não te ouve. Não, de qualquer das maneiras, ele não te ouve.
O que é que disseste?
É surdo! Ouves?
O que é que disseste?
É surdo!
Eu não percebi!
É surdo!
Não disseste.
Assustadora sombra.
Que queres dizer?
A passagem do tempo.
Sombras. Somos apenas sombras.
Relógios de sol.
Viste aquele? Que condição! Quase me atingiu. Nem devia ter carta.
Amor, estás a ficar uma pilha de nervos. Sem paciente, acabarão por colocar-te novamente em cima do passeio. Para de ver condutores, sem escrúpulos, em todo lado.
Sim. Para ti é fácil dizer. Experimenta pôr aqui o pescoço. Vê lá o que te acontece.
Aqui permaneço Pinheiro.
Vazio.
Bom dia.
Din din din. The road... has no meaning of its own. Only the two points it connects have meaning. The way is an homage to space.
The end of the city isn't just an ending in and of itself. It is no longer nature, it is no longer the countryside, it is no longer the suburbs.
It is the multiplied city.
Layering landscapes.
Autistic limits.
Nostalgic glances. The roads ignore the former use of the soil, but they do not hide it.
Abandon a spotlight on dead landscapes.
Energy scapes.
Cutting edges.
The urbanized countryside.
Prefab limits.
The border between the city and the water.
The copy-paste global image of urbanism album.
Background noise.
The conflict between density and mobility.
A low-density city is no city at all, and it isn't the countryside either. So what it is?
Gasolina, do, no worries, international semaphore coming up the blue pump, self-serve, price is unbelievable over here, doesn't seem to discourage anyone from driving. My first experience of Portugal, probably should have had a look at Lisbon, but wanted to get on the road, who am I, fucking Kerouac? These acoustic barriers are truly beyond ugly. Did someone actually sit down and design the things? Looks like a shopping mall in New Mexico. Warm colors? TIR, what the fuck is that? These fences are just welfare for construction companies. We're in the EU and we build to the standard. Guardrails, smooth curves, emergency phones at correct intervals. Clean places to relieve yourself, civilization. Helps not to have ice and snow. On the other hand, a few serious potholes might slow down these arrogant sons of bitches and their Beamers and Mercs. Why did I rent this economy car? Broom, broom. How many miles per hour is 100 kilometers per clamp together under their endless tile roofs? Not a tree sprouting. Dish antennas pointing like heliotropes to the same source of geosynchronous threat. Wonder what's actually happening inside? Same as anywhere. Couples screwing. Children abused. Fido shitting on the carpet, granny expiring in her bed. Finally, we can rent the room. Developers get rich on the same old, minimum quality for maximum people. The atmosphere is electric. A truly unbelievable number of giant pylons out there. Where do these people get their energy? Some toxic plant burning fossils? Some nuke. Vladimir Putin? Why don't they use this goddamn sun for something other than giving themselves melanomas? Those apartment blocks on the hilltops with those scrubby valleys between. Those smug little villages all whitewashed and for sale to the right people, clustered together on the cheap. This could be Orange County, or Palestine. How about the radio? There is culture out here. Only it's ours. The whole top 40 for the last 70 years. Is there a Portuguese Elvis? Tony Carrera, what possessed me to drive to Spain? Could have left the car and taken a train. Let me close my eyes for a microsecond. A nap in the blink of an eye. Could probably put the thing on autopilot and doze off for 10 minutes and the landscape would be the same. Put the thing on autopilot for the next week. Is it possible that there's only one highway on the planet and they just alter the view minutely to keep up the illusion that you're going someplace?
The city and the mountains. Shadows of the city.
Where does my tap water come from?
Which mountain was quarried to produce the cement used to build my house?
Where the bones of the fishes I just ate end up?
How far do the tentacles of the city in which I live extend?
And therefore the limits of my body and my being. Abandoning the car. Asking for the impossible? Long live the multimodal citizen. 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 In order to be able to intervene in it, we might have to come up with rurbanism.
Where
are
we
going?
Thank you.
So, and now I can take my hat. Good evening, everyone. My name is Eduardo, and together with the architect Pedro Campos Costa, we are the authors of the project Seven Circles, mapping the boundaries of today's city, which bring us here today. We decide to start this lecture in an unconventional way, if I can say like that, with a theatrical performance of the book Seven Circles made by Mando Pinheiro and Martinho Silva. And the reason for this was because through this rather unorthodox performance, we managed to share with you quite effectively, we think, the different layers that make up this project on this fascinating topic about the limits and the boundaries of the city. I start by thanking to the AEA School of Architecture and his director, Brett, still for this invitation, and also all his team, especially to Manije and also Nuria. Thank you for all the support during the preparation of this event. And I also want to give a warm welcome to our two invited guests, the architect Mary Bauman, thank you, Mary, and the architect Mariana Pestana. Thank you both for your presence here today. And thank you, Mary, once more for having accepted our challenge to embark at that journey, which was the publication of the book Seven Circles, that had as main goal the same reason that brings us here today. That is to put in question the limits of this the contemporary city by taking a new look, as Nuria already said, at the landscape and the territory of Lisbon. That was our case study, and is the territory where also Pedro and I live. This journey of the Seven Circles was officially started in November of last year when we organized the first international conference in Portugal in the city of Porto. And in this conference, we also invite Mary Bauman as keynote speaker. And so, almost a year later, and being this lecture the last official event of our project under grants that we had from the government of Portugal, again with Mary, we also closed the cycle. And since that conference, it became clear that research on the limits of Lisbon should try to leap over the fences of its territory, since some of the issues we set out to analyze were and are shared by many other urban realities, as you can see here. Just a few examples, and London is also represented by Sinclair's book, London Orbital. And since then, the set of events we did during the last year and the success achieved was only possible thanks to the support of all our institutional, financial, and media partners who have joined us in this process, but also all partners that have been supporting us in more than a dozen of events, conference from north to south Portugal, and also photography exhibitions where we have also shown the work of Eduardo Bello and Tiago Casanova, two photographers that work with us during this project, and even a theatrical performance, as you saw today. That said, this project had this dual dimension. On one hand, the publication of the book, and on the other, this series of conferences and exhibitions that we did over the last year. And with this set of images, we try to give you an idea of the second life of the project after the publication of the book. In this short presentation, I will try to explain you the genesis of the project and some of the questions that we set out to investigate. There is, in the title of the project, and also in the title of the book, an intentional parabola. From one side, the number seven, that will give obvious reference to the collective imagination of the inhabitants of Lisbon, known as the City of the Seven Hills, a designation that Lisbon borrowed from the city of Rome. But in this case, it's not so much the number seven that we'd like to point out, but rather the idea that the landscape of Lisbon, paraphrasing Simon Schema, is built up as much from strata of memory as from layers of rock. And this movement between nature and culture, between rock and memory, is what generates the life of the city and its landscape. On the other hand, we have the idea of circle that came from the radiocentric model of Lisbon, established definitely in the urbanization plan of 1948 for the city. But the idea of circle takes us back to the word car from the Indo-European, which means move around, investigate, research, or round and round to look, almost like a spiritual exercise. And that's exactly what we did, looking for the Lisbon region, to its terrarium, to the metropolitan area, and to the entire landscape of the hydrographic basin of the River Tagus. Literally, we walk around, looking around. And in an attempt to better understand the city boundaries, the exercise we set ourselves was to build a mapping of this reality. In this line of dough, an important reference regarding the conference, regarding the city boundaries, was the work of Augusto Vieira da Silva, a historical report entitled The Boundaries of Lisbon, published in 1941, where Vieira da Silva analyzed several boundaries established by decree. But unlike Augusto Vieira da Silva, the exercise we set out was another. In our opinion, we less regard the idea of territory and their administrative boundaries, but instead support by an idea of landscape resulting from the interaction between the way as each one of us understands and transforms a certain space where we live, and the physical and biophysical process that take place in that space and transform us, each and everyone, with the same force. And so, the definition of these circles was closely engaged to the layers of information that generate those landscapes, which, in each case, had different protagonists. On each circle, sometimes the topography was the main protagonist, sometimes was the type of substrate, sometimes the infrastructure, etc. Or in the case of the seventh circle, the circle of Mary Bauman, the idea of limits was represented by the watershed of the River Tagus. In short, and in other words, the circles correspond to the sets of marks that build up the landscape of Lisbon.
So I would also like to join the warm welcome to Mariana and Mary, and thank, of course, AA for the invitation. I'd love to be here. And I will add to what Eduardo says to explain a bit the background, how it came up, Seven Circles, and the past and the future of it. So actually, this is a blackboard that I have it in my office. And it's a blackboard that I show explaining that my office is a kind of anti-heroical office. Not very typical, we don't have formulas, but it's, of course, not good, but at least it's we have a lot of fun working on discovering how to tackle the problems. And we do a lot of stuff. So we do from books, from photography, art installations, etc. And on this office, we also discuss a lot about territorium. We met in the office, working in different projects, and that's why we came up with Seven Circles. I would say that the office doesn't have specific boundaries, what is, of course, very difficult nowadays, especially the media and the standards and what is the notion of architectural office does or should do. So we came up with this diagram that it's, of course, what architects do. They do projects, they build, and they do research, explaining a bit better and very fast forward. We do very large-scale plans, urban plans. And we are doing now urban park in the north of Lisbon. We do architecture as, let's say, what is actually we do more. And when we can build, we build. We do installations, scenographies, etc. But this part, as this research, where it comes these two books, also the Biennale of Venice, where I was the curator of the Portuguese Pavilion. But these books are actually what I'm going to explain a bit now. So the two lines was 2009, and it came from one idea that I think everybody knows this. This is a travel, for maybe the greatest travel, but also the greatest moment to create a narrative. And this was, of course, very ambitious and also very arrogant. But we wanted to travel in our country, in Portugal, and we wanted to create a new narrative through this travel. So we know that architects do narratives. We do narratives. This is Brumtaut sketches in Japan. They do narratives doing its sketchbooks. For sure, you know Caesar's sketchbook and Corbusier's sketchbook. We all build up these narratives, trying to create places, new places, and new narratives for our projects. Another reference for us, what's very important, was the photographies. Not only architecture tools we use photography mainly as a tool. So Ajed was the first one that managed to create this new look to see other parts of Paris in his time. So for us, we also wanted to show other parts that was not seen. So also at Reschner in America in the 63, he made this book of 26 gasoline stations. That was for us also a reference, and it influenced a lot the way that the person starts seeing American urban scape. Portugal has this thing that we have 70% of our population in the coast, really in the coast, until the border with Spain. And the border with Spain is practically empty. So we wanted to show this contrast, and we wanted to travel through these two lines and to build up this narrative. We used, again, a geometry, so we made several lines, several latitudes, 10 and 10 kilometers, and we took a picture each time that we crossed this latitude. So then we came up with images like that. That was fantastic. We like very much this one. That is the entrancing in two cities. One, it's Lisbon. Another one is a small village in the interior of Portugal. Or like these ones that are not, there are walls separating the natural world from the urbanized or infrastructure world. Or these ones, the contrast between nature and infrastructure. Or even these ones that are kind of bucolic image and the urbanization. Or even this one that switch completely the image, the infrastructure becomes in the interior and in the coast becomes the natural bucolic thing. So this project was for us the starting point to a lot of stuff because it was had a huge promotion from the media and it became, let's say, very important step to go to this one that we are presenting today, the Seven Circles. Seven Circles come adding to a bit of another notion to what Eduardo said, is that the urban space changed a lot and very quickly, which changed relations with the landscape and necessarily with the communities, but we keep this image of Lorenzetti, that is a painting from the Renaissance, as a kind of image that always stick to us, that we have a wall and in one side, we have the city, in the other side, we have the countryside. So, and we continue not having vocabulary to define a different syntax to this new urban life. So that was the reason to do this book. We cannot use anymore the palimpsest, we cannot use, again, the block and other approaches. So the question is we apply this methodology like in the other book, also a geometry, but this time the circles. But actually, I think we can apply this to another types of cities. So I think the interesting here is actually to understand that we can connect, and that's why I explained a bit the study work, that we connect our practice with the research and to find out ways of looking at the territorium. And for us, this was an experience to learn a lot about the territorium and learn how to look to the urban life and landscape. So we're going to have a third book that is 100 points. There is no date because these books are random, so we have to raise funding to make them. But I can tell that it's going to be about rural life, because it's a team that architects and rural plannings and politicians, and especially in Portugal, in the last decades didn't give much attention. So we're going to focus on that. And to pass to the debate, I'm going to show as a provocation for the debate. I hope that it's going to be a good starting point. An installation that I made in 2002 with my wife in the hospital for mad people. And I was invited with artists to make the installation inside that building. But I found out that this garden, very anonymous garden and kind of dodgy thing, that could be interesting to make something. So what I did was actually we put powder, white powder, from that you normally use to the bottoms of the babies. And we put this white powder all over the garden. So it became completely white. We transformed completely this landscape. And the anonymous garden became a place to take pictures. It changed completely. Also the smell, also the texture. The kids started running on it and they became all white, as you can imagine. And this was a discovery, a new landscape. In the other day, in the morning, it rained and it disappeared, the installation. So I normally show this image because I believe that being an architect is to engage with landscape and the social and cultural context. We normally do not accept the idea of temporary. Being an architect is accepting that we transform socially, physically, metaphorically, even building, and we creating new narratives, even if it's for 1 second, 1 minute, 1 hour, 1 week, or a few centuries. Thank you.
Hello, hi everyone. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here and share this discussion. And it's wonderful to just see images of my country against this, like the performance and the music was really great. Thank you for that. I know that Pedro kind of threw me this little, he didn't tell me about the last project that he was going to present because he thought it would, because I prepared my questions and he thought that this project would just make me, I don't know, just forget about all my questions and start afresh at the beginning of the, but so perhaps the way I make sense of it is to, is that perhaps the idea that was, you know, in reading the book and in listening to the presentation, there's this almost puzzling idea, which is that on the one hand, we are talking about the, you know, the urban space in a very broad sense, in the urban space as a fluid territory in terms of its, the fact that we live in a, you know, in an age where we're hyper-connected, where we can click in London and interact with someone across the globe, the fact that we drink water, you know, in the kitchen next door, but we're actually making, you know, perhaps sourcing water from kilometers away, and that puzzling idea that that you, on the one hand, you want to talk about the territory as this complex entity, and you do that by defining very precise geometric forms like the line or the circle. And that was going to be my first question. What is, you know, why do you define such a precise, pure geometry shape to talk about, you know, the impossibility of that shape? And perhaps it's this element of strangeness, right? The creation of these rules that allow you as an observer to establish a relationship of strangeness with this territory, which is not far from what you were doing at the psychiatric hospital, perhaps, which is to introduce an element that all of a sudden makes you look at this garden in a completely different way, that you have, I don't know, is that, does that make sense?
Go ahead. The geometry, the impossibility of the geometry, mm-hmm. of course, allows you to treat a theme that it's impossible to treat because this urban scale, it's super hyper big and it's very difficult to tackle it. So the geometry helps you to give a kind of contour. Mm-hmm. It helps you to give rules, helps you to give a lot of. But actually, there is a very, I find it kind of similar because you introduce another element that actually transform, mm-hmm. because this element is what it creates the narrative. In the seven circles is more clear than in two lines because the seven circles, it's seven columns of Lisbon. And of course they don't exist, it's a narrative. We don't have seven columns, we have five columns, to the person who don't know. But it was a thing that was created by a king because he wanted to have seven columns like Rome. So now we have seven columns, even if we don't have them. So it's a narrative that was glued to us, was sticked to us. So the seven circles, it's also again a kind of narrative. So we build up a narrative with our tools to create territorium.
I would like to also to add something that is, in somehow I see that as also a provocation in a way of discussing the idea of limits and the idea of boundary. That is what Seven Circle is about. And for instance, since 19th century at least, we had this separation between science in somehow and art. And so when you look to these, as you said, these mathematical, let's say, geometry, very precise, for that you can see on these radial, different radials that we draw, that's is totally true. But actually, when you overlap the circles and you see the all the different travels and walks along these circles are not circles at all. So it's always this overlapping of these, if you want, a scientific way of looking to the landscape, but also a more subjective way. And you can talk about landscape without talking about these two realities. And another thing that I totally forgot, basically was especially this, also a provocation of that.
Mm-hmm. Mary, we were just talking before here about your, you contributed to the book, that's in part what brings you here. And we were discussing this, how in your essay, you were in charge of the seventh circle, perhaps we should start there, which is the furthest away from the epicenter. And you, in writing about this circle, you had to sort of navigate it in some way. And that circle crossed water sources, dams, and a lot of sort of infrastructural elements of the city that in some ways we could even consider that they're no longer part of the city. But you articulate this difference by making this relationship between culture and nature and how the two are intimately connected. So I wonder if you could talk us a little bit through that connection and perhaps through some of the projects in your practice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. First of all, thank you to Eduardo and Pedro for giving me the opportunity to contribute to their book. It's always a nice thing to do to slightly step outside of your day-to-day practice and have the opportunity to think about landscape on a, you know, in a different way. And I really enjoyed the way that you've presented the book and the music and the theater and the kind of the lectures and. It's a really nice way to practice. But anyway, I was given the seventh circle, which was the outermost territory. And I guess I took the opportunity to talk a bit more about landscape. In a way, borders don't exist when you're talking about a landscape. And the Tagus River, the Tejo goes way up into Spain. It crosses borders. It doesn't recognize geographical or political borders. And then there's a watershed that comes back down to the Mediterranean around Valencia with the River Turia. And there, so I took the opportunity to talk about a project that we're doing in Valencia, which is about that wider territory and how you interpret the landscape and the sort of the natural forms and territories that the river goes through in a landscape that then becomes a cultural landscape in the middle of the city. So we looked at all of the kind of the regions that the Turia comes down through, from the mountains to the the huerta that surrounds Valencia, the really rich agricultural belt, to the Albufera, where all the rice is grown, to the Mediterranean Sea. So you have this journey from freshwater to brackish to seawater and so on. And then started to talk a bit about how we then interpret those natural characteristics into a very man-made and and cultural landscape, and how within the park then we tried to express those natural features and the plant material and into a cultural landscape that people recognize as part of their region, and then can relate to it. It evokes memories of a much wider territory within the confines of a city park.
Thank you. Yeah, I think it's really interesting how even when you were describe the circle, and that was very much my experience, and I'm sure many of us have experienced today, to see all of these elements together. I just wrote a few of them, but like, you know, nature, fitness, lamps, trees, cars, passages, motors, arrows. So all of these elements, almost in a presented in this flat hierarchy in the photograph and the text, and this is juxtaposition. And in a sense, they're presented as like forensic material for us to kind of discuss the city afresh or the boundaries. And of course, that is the result of a series of collaborations on top of each other, of which perhaps the theater performance is, the one that we've just built today. And we are in a school of architecture, but these collaborations that you did for the purpose of the book, which, with writers, artists, mm-hmm. historians, and so on. I mean, what was it that you were looking to capture that didn't? That wouldn't be captured with a purely sort of architectural view, or what is the excess that a kind of collaborative interdisciplinary?
No, because I think at least for we are normally always have different opinions, so I hope we keep the tradition. But for sure, the city is not from one subject; mm-hmm. it's a multidisciplinary city. Yeah. So if you go to especially on this is much more multidisciplinary, much more complex book than the two lines.
Mm-hmm.
The two lines is much more romantic narrative, very much Portuguese. You cannot export it to another country, I think. This book is much more complex, has much more disciplines, and we wanted to, of course, to try to define or to limit, that's why we have these limits,
mm-hmm.
to or these circles, to try to be more broad possible. And actually, the reason why we made the theater performance, there Amanda and Martin that made the brilliant, especially Amanda, you made the brilliant mm-hmm. adaptation of the texts, made another, and because we were doing lectures, and me and Eduardo, we were saying, my God, this is super, how can we explain? This is so much information. This is so many things to explain. It's super complex. Each circle, we can make a lecture of 3 hours, easily. So how can you do this? So we decide to make a theater play that would somehow, with another view, with another layer on top, with the define with another eyes, in a very broad sense. Of course, you see another thing. It's another, let's say, not object, another play. It's another work on top of another work. But you have an impression of the book. The first time that we saw mm-hmm. the theater play, I was surprised because I thought, wow, this is it's actually the book, because if you read it, you can have actual impression of the book. Mm-hmm. So this complexity, it's very difficult to, and because we are in architectural school, to do it with one discipline.
Mm-hmm.
And of course you need another discipline, and the synthesis, especially in art or in poetry or in philosophy, helps you a lot on to actually define and to try to understand what's going on.
I'm sorry, but I will agree with you.
No.
For the first time. No, but seriously, also now I remember the second part of the first question that I'd like to answer, that in somehow it's also connected with the second question from you. That is, for instance, Pedro, as I told before, Pedro and I, we are from, we're born in Lisbon, we are from Lisbon, we work in Lisbon. So to make a book, to make a project like this about a city that is your city,
mm-hmm.
it's, I always use this metaphor, but it's, and somehow, as when I look to the mirror, and try to describe myself.
Yeah.
So, and again, these very objective approach that we start with the radial lines also help us to find these points that were points that we find as with GPS. And so we had the possibility to go to went to these places, places where the majority of them we never stopped on that places yeah. to look around and to see that reality. So that was the first part of the question that I think, and also in a certain point, in a certain moment, I was looking to the book and looking to the title. And I, because of that, I think you also can call to this book Seven Mirrors, because if you live on the city of Lisbon, you can look to each one of these circles and you can recognize your circle or not. So I think that the circle is also all these methodologies also about that. But the second thing that I would like to add to your question is that the reason also we are all invite all these different people from these different backgrounds. For instance, my background is in landscape architecture that I also consider as a synthesis discipline, or a discipline that normally works with, needs to make synthesis of different, also taking information for other different disciplines. And so to have a totally, or at least the truly, or the more profound and complex answer to a landscape that it's always made by these these different layers and the overlapping of these different layers. I really like this quote of Simon Schemer when he talks that a landscape is not just about layers of rock that normally we don't forget, but we probably forget that landscape is also about layers of memory. And so the overlap, the way of overlapping these two realities and to have the better answer to that, I think was the need that we find to invite all these different authors from different backgrounds.
Do you want to comment?
No, I just think it is, you know, the practice of landscape is, it does take on many different subjects and territories. It's not just about, you know, often I was like, what do you do? What, you know, do we do the plants? No, we don't just do the plants. We are, you know, it takes on infrastructure, it takes on civil engineering, it takes on, you know, loads of environmental aspects. It is really a kind of broad-reaching subject, and it happens on many different layers and levels. And I guess my little plea is I always wish at the AA there would be more of a landscape kind of interest. I know there's a landscape urbanism and so on, but you know, it's such a kind of fundamental thing when you're talking about urbanism or master planning or the design of individual buildings that I think it should be much more prevalently taught, you know, much more important in the school.
And this was also the reason why we invite Mary, because we totally agree with the, mm-hmm. not just with this vision, but especially with their practice and the work from your office that I think in somehow materialized perfectly all this complexity and diversity that we also try to celebrate on this book.
Brilliant. Yeah, and also you were talking about seven circles, and I know that the book was also at some point thought of as, you were talking about seven mirrors, sorry, mm-hmm. and the book is called Seven Circles, but it was thought of at some point as seven walls. Which is
six,
interesting.
Six
walls. Oh, was it six?
Yeah, because he made the seven.
So the last circle that is the seventh circle, the circle that we invite Mary, it's all, again a provocation that corresponds to the watershed of the River Tagus. Yeah. And if you look, I also did this a few weeks ago, and if you look the area of the entire watershed of the River Tagus, and if you look to the area of Portugal, you see that they are almost the same area. So we are again, when we are, so we overlap so much the metropolitan area of the city. But this was also a critic, a provocation, if you want, to this world of the technology. And when I'm saying about the world of technology, of course, I'm not against technology, but in somehow, and all the evolution of the last 20th century, allow us to build cities. And this, of course, was in somehow a way of thinking that we had, especially during the Enlightenment period. But this connection of the cities regarding the context that in somehow the technology allow us to do it. Mm-hmm. When we putting the watershed of the River Tagus as the last circle, it's also a kind of last note saying, come on guys, we are not totally independent of the context, so mm-hmm. we shouldn't forget that it still matters. And I think that was the reason for the 7th circle.
The walls was about the image that I showed, the Lorenzetti, no? It was a straightforward metaphor to Lorenzetti, because we were speaking about limits of city. What is the limit of the city? And like I said in the presentation, the contemporary city, nowadays the urban space changed completely, and we keep going on this image of Lorenzetti that has 500 years, and we continue looking to it as a kind of image that for us is comfortable. It's very difficult because this palimpsest, it never changed so much the city in the last 100 years. And if you go through the literature, you mm-hmm. see a lot of change. And everybody's trying to describe it, and we don't have vocabulary. So this was the idea of the book, to try to understand how can we define, or find a new vocabulary through the pictures, through art. We invite artists, we invite another things to try to arrange another syntax, because it's very difficult to nowadays to understand the urban life and the urban context.
Thank you. Perhaps we should open up to
that would be lovely.
Yeah, to the public. I'm sure many of you will have questions. Does anyone have a question? Yeah, put one there. Mm-hmm.
No, I was just thinking about how sort of the act of defining things, how that perhaps either inspires creativity or potentially restricts it.
Defining.
Yeah, the act of defining something, mm-hmm. and sort of how people respond to that. Whether you think people are, you know, potential, whether that provokes innovation, seems that, or whether perhaps it potentially stifles it, or whether different people,
how the persons react to our proposal. Now, everybody reacts very well, but actually we were surprised with the reactions of the inviter, that the persons that we invite to this, and I think defining, and we send the pictures to them to see what we have done. And we were even surprised, very much surprised. One on the performance, on the theater performance, the biggest text when he's playing and Martinho is going from one side to another is from a Portuguese writer called Gonçalves Tavares. And it's very, very nice, the text, all the text. And he react in a very nice way, because I thought he would never accept it, because he's a famous writer, makes big novels, and he would say, but he was super, super interested. He took a lot of time, I don't know, like 3 months, 4 months, a lot of time. But when I call him, he was always saying, it's super interesting, Pedro, I'm interested, but I'm just in the circle too. And because and for him was very interesting, the suggestion, because he doesn't do that. No one gives him a photo and he has to write. So he was very interested on this exercise. For a writer, I think it must be interesting. And it was nice because in the talks with him, we discover, because he was giving me examples of philosophers and other things like Sloterdijk, that now I like a lot. On these conversations, we learn also a lot with the other writers. For example, Sarmiento Matos, that is a super famous Portuguese expert of the city of Lisbon. We passed like several lunches with him, and he was always talking about the story of the city. And this was very enthusiastic, and I don't think creativity, let's say, stops with definitions. I think it's, I don't say that it's blocks, but it's a way to start as well.
I think the circles just gave a framework for endless kind of possibilities. You could interpret it however you wanted. I don't think there, and there wasn't any...
strict.
No, there was no prescribed way that one should go about it from the authors. So in a way, it was very free. It just gave you a kind of a reference point for, you know, a framework for what you could talk about or express. So.
Any other questions? Right? We've got...
Hi. Obrigada. Thank you for the presentation. It's inspirational. Being Portuguese and an architect, you end up giving, and from Lisbon as well, you give me a new perspective of my city, and that's also always special. My question is actually regarding the seven circles. Pedro, at a certain time, you mentioned, at a certain time of the presentation, you mentioned you could relate this book to other cities, but at the same time, I understand what you're saying, because it is an urban space, but the seven circles, like Eduardo was mentioning, it kind of mirrors the culture and people's lives and how they leave the space. And in that sense, do you think you will be able to do a quick match between, you know, be able to match the seven circles Lisbon to any European city or world city?
No, all the radiant cities can be applied. For example, London, Milano, all the cities that have a radial status, you can apply them. But of course, they're... This, it's a nice methodology. We're going to do a PhD. I'm joking. Because we were speaking about making a PhD about it. But no, but you can actually use this methodology and transform it in a kind that you to use in other cities. But of course, it will mirror always the quality of that cities, I think, or the quality of the inner thing. That's the quality of this methodology, because you have to go to that point and make that picture. In the beginning, when I did the two lines, there is a guy who, that is a mobility engineering, they call Mario Alves. He wrote a thing that is very nice, that he said that in the time of Google, you don't need to do this project. But actually, what is nice is when you go there to that point, you take the picture as you want it. So if you do you or any of you would do this methodology, you would have a completely different book. Because these pictures is my look and Eduardo's from that point. And you stay in the point. You know, the rule is that you have to stay in the point. And you can do whatever you want, but you have to stay in the point. That's the only rule. But it's gonna be completely different, because our view of the places are completely different. And in the Google, you are not there. And now we can open a big discussion about what is new technology. But I think it makes much more sense now that there is Google than without Google.
Oh, but just to add a question an answer to the question of Mariana, I think these we show at a certain point in our presentation, there are also different works that already look to these circle cities. So, and we could give a different examples. The work of Ian Sinclair, I think it's the way out, the right way of pronounce London Orbital, that he walks exactly around the M25 here in London. So also the Sacro Gra in Rome. So, and also different cities were not exactly with this kind of methodology, but again, try to look to these different circles, or at least some of these circles, to try to understand the evolution of the city. So, and this is also a challenge that we'd like to put to you and to all the audience, that come on, each one of you, in each one of your cities, please try to...
circles.
Try to do circles. And
go around in circles.
Then try to, let's try to see what the results are, and if makes sense to compare or not. But at some point, that was also the... And again, the abstraction, or the, and somehow the abstract geometry that we create also allow that that way of putting in other realities. And that, of course, it's something that we'd like to do it. Right now, we're probably, one of our next projects will be the Two Lines Europe. So. okay, we change a little bit the scale, but
it would be interesting to do it in London, actually, because there's the high street where all the commerce happens, all the commercial activities. There aren't so many squares, and it's more like high street, and the street just behind would be very interesting to do two lines across the road. What do you think?
It's a challenge.
My question is, and going back to the last image, that is something that, like, we all, as an architects, we always like to take control, but then there's no control at all. This is an illusion. And since we are in a school and we are thinking about cities, this is an individual question for each one of you, because
cities are simply changing, and those circles, even that we map in each other, they disappear at some point. Some cities more than others, we see from London, how things are changing. And now with homogenization of the cities, with the same similar shops opening up, the Airbnbs and the Uber, these limits, what is actually different between Berlin and Lisbon? What is actually different from London and in Lisbon, you can find the same shops? Who can say to find the same shops is the people changing and moving into places? And again, going to the same installation you tried to do it with, to spread the powder. Like we are, because we spread our scene and we try to build our buildings and try to make an image and almost like put our alter ego with a tower, with a certain building. Does it matter anything at some point that is actually has like a span of 10, 30, 40 years? That span that is actually getting smaller and smaller because things change. And since, again, like since we are in a school, and for young architects and for us as an architects, each individually, all of you, like, how do you think, like, what is the city? For example, I live almost like 10 years in Lisbon and I found a totally different Lisbon. Does it actually make sense, those certain circles? Like, we are speaking about mirrors, I don't see so much about mirrors. I actually see, like, it's a beast that is changing, is changing, like, in a speed that we cannot control. Again, like, going through the last installations, you don't have control, even if you try to. It has an architect, we go for this perceived idea of perfection, when actually, is there any perfection? But again, the question is, how do you see, after doing this book, after this research, and it almost like after 1 year of this journey, like, what do you find now? What actually, like, how do you see Lisbon? And like, what has changed your perspective as an architect and actually like having an impact? Having in mind that we all of here are going to have an impact on the cities, if there are going to be any cities.
What I like about the practice of landscape architecture is that it is very specific. You can't just do the same thing in London as you can do in Portugal or in Singapore or somewhere else, because we're so driven by the environment and, you know, what will grow there, how hot is it, how humid is it, all those things that are extremely site specific and which form the kind of character of the place are the things that we try to bring out. We can only, we're not gonna plant pine trees in a tropical environment and so on. So, and I guess in our work, we always try and express the kind of, the nature of the place and interpret the, the quality of the place through the landscape. And maybe it's, how do you be site-specific and so on? Maybe it's, in a way, I think it's easier to do in landscape because that's, you have to respond to your environment or it doesn't survive, it dies. And so I guess that's the, you know, that's the richness of it and the kind of challenge in any, you know, in a different environment or different city that you're working in. It's, there might be, you know, Uber and chain shops, but you can't translate some very fundamental things which are to do with nature.
As I said, somehow I already answered, no, with my presentation, that the architects, they change the cities, they change the urban space and the urban quality, even if it's for 1 second. And of course, the cities change a lot, and that's why we do, and that was the necessity of doing this project, because we wanted to map it, we wanted to somehow have a reference, somehow to map it, even if it disappears in 1 second. The city changed a lot in this year. In the last, Lisbon changed super radically, especially in the last 5 years. And now it's different, and it will be much different in the next 10 years, like all the cities. That doesn't mean that you don't need to disappear as well. We are persons, we are architects, we can continue doing our job, doing probably in a different way. So, especially trying to look in different angles and different perspectives and try to adapt and try to understand. Because I'm totally, that's my way to see architecture, that architects have to be engaged with landscape. That's why I do mm-hmm. these wonderful projects mm-hmm. and I always like to do projects with the landscape architects, also other subjects, but especially landscape architects. But it's very much engaged with the landscape and the urban planning and cultural thing and social. So it's very difficult. You are connected, you are not disconnected. And it's typical that we believe, probably from your words I understood that somehow there is a kind of a notion that architects are disconnected somehow from this engagement. But I don't know if it's totally true. I don't have a PhD or a research on that, but I think that it's not so radical as it seems like. Because even Dubai, if you want to shift conversation to other places, for example, even in Dubai, there is an engagement that it's, of course, through economy and through social and cultural, but it's totally artificial and it's completely made, and we'll see how long it will last, this artificiality. But I will pass to Eduardo with this thing. Landscape is built by men, so a lot of things are built by us. So the level of the artificiality that we are doing and this engagement with the social and the landscape depends of how much we want to do it. I don't know if I was clear, but...
Damn it, again, I agree with you. But no, thank you for your question. And even if I think I don't agree with your vision, at least in a certain part. And the reason for that is that from one side, for instance, if you you were saying that if I understood the right, the circles, in somehow these circles, the mirrors, doesn't exist. But
they may disappear or not.
No, but of course. No, of course.
Right?
But that.
So,
but
the whole point we manage with narratives, and again, like going back to the question that.
But
it's just like how this book has a deep impact.
Yes.
No, but you never know.
You can see these, if you want, these circles exactly as the powder installation of Pedro. If it rains tomorrow, if the collective imagination of the inhabitants of Lisbon will decide to put water on these circles, they will disappear. If the collective imagination of the inhabitants of Lisbon decide to keep it and almost as a no way paradox, and they won't try to conserve it, they will grow on their collective imagination, like the expression of the city of seven hills, that was again another narrative that you can say that works or not to Lisbon. But I was thinking, for instance, if you that for one side, the other side, that the contexts always matter, and at a certain point we can't even if to the, for instance, and sorry, I have to talk about in situ and in visu, But when people ask me a better definition to the word landscape, I always use three words to try to define it. And I always use the idea of in situ, and when I'm talking about in situ, it's about the material or the physical world, if I can say like that. And in visu, the collective imagination that each one of us and also collectively used to read the world around us. But these two dimensions of the landscape separate doesn't make any sense. So this movement that the French philosopher Auguste Lambert used to describe this movement between these two realities, actually it's what makes landscape. And so we can never forget the context. We can never, or if we do, now I was remember the project of the Venetian, for instance, in Las Vegas, in Macau, when we make copy paste of a certain of an in situ and try to put that in situ on another total reality without having regarding the context of that in visu, immediately we have several detachments or several abstractions regarding that that's reality. And also on your question, you're asking what are the changes that are happening right now on this reality that in somehow will transform also the landscape of Lisbon, but also different realities. And I again, to use this metaphor, right now I think a bit, for instance, if we compare, and this is my personal opinion, if we compare the today's city with, for instance, medieval times, I think on that time we had a wall, we had this in situ wall, if I can call it like that. And I think in somehow the in visu wall that each one of that communities had at the time was almost, almost coincident.
It was the same as the world.
Almost the same area, if I can say like that. And as you were saying, today we our in visu can be, I can live in Lisbon, but my in visu can be connected in the other side of the world. So I think in somehow this big challenge that we have today, it's exactly how to work with in visus and in situs that in somehow are so disconnected. So how this movement again, these two dimensions can be continue and transform the landscape and transform us. And I hope it makes sense.
Thanks. I don't know how we're doing in terms of time. Should we probably have to draw this to a close? Yeah. So thank you so much. I think what we take. I don't know what I take from all of these is just the sense that that all of these, that first of all, this discussion just raises a lot of further discussions. So you're not closing the city into circles, you're literally opening it up. I mean, it just seems so relevant today when we've never been as connected as a globe, but we've never, perhaps this is a moment where we're daily discussing boundaries, walls in political debate. So I think to think about, you know, what is the limits or the boundary of a city from an architecturally driven, at least, perspective is it just seems so relevant and so contemporary nowadays. So I wanted to thank you for that. I think the conversation will continue for sure outside. So
no,
please.
On that room. Oh. So we have a drinks reception. So
right. Yeah.
We invite you all, and also you can continue the conversation on that room.
Right. So welcome, join me, thanking our speakers here.